channel, and if you're new here, just welcome in general to my channel for the first time. Today I'm just going to do a couple of announcements, actually. I'm kind of excited. Thank you to all of my new subscribers, to everyone who supported me with my videos and all of your wonderful comments. I've just really been feeling the love and appreciation, and I've even had some private messages on Instagram and stuff, so I just want to say thank you so much for supporting me in this, because it's a creative endeavor and you're putting yourself out there and you never know what you're going to get back. Today I'm going to do a Q&A. It's my first Q&A, and a few people have asked me to do a Q&A, and then in general I get a lot of questions either about vintage products or about the videos that I've put up, but a lot of the questions are like more general about my life and who I am and what I do when I'm not on YouTube and stuff like that, so I thought I would do a general Q&A video. And I also want to announce that this month, month of April, I have decided to do the 30 videos in 30 days challenge. I'm a little bit nervous because I probably honestly don't have the time to be uploading a video every day, but I really feel like the age-old motto of if you want to do something one day, you should do it now, really applies here. Like, I really want to be regularly uploading on my channel, and the only way that that's really going to happen is if I just start doing that. So I thought this would be a good way to kind of kick myself in the butt and get started. I probably won't continue to upload every day because, I can't justify that. I have to work, and the hours that I like to spend on videos, I have to be earning money. But I think maybe it might inspire me to do more than once a weekly upload. So we will see. No promises yet, but for this month, you're going to get a video every day. So yay or boo. I don't know. That's up to you. I'm sure you'll let me know. So let's start this Q&A. The first question comes from Kitten on a Cloud, almost from YouTube. Are you living abroad for good? What made you decide on Paris? For good is a difficult question. For the foreseeable future, I mean, I don't think you can ever truly know what you're going to do forever, because opportunities arise and you take them and things change. So yes, my plan was to move overseas without the intention of moving home again. So there is nothing for me at home in that I left my job and I left my apartment. I don't have a room with my lovely friends anymore. I'm sure someone will be kind enough to put me up, but I don't actually have a room that I'm renting and paying for. And I told everyone that I was leaving and not coming back. So yeah, that's the plan. What made me decide on Paris? There was lots of things that made me decide on Paris, but I'm not going to lie, the first and foremost reason was Val. But beyond that, I had been wanting to move overseas for a really long time. I decided when I was about 14 years old that I wanted to live overseas during my life. I wanted to have an adventure and I wanted to experience the world. That's always been very important to me and a really big goal. So I always told myself that I would live in New York, Paris, and London. I don't know why, just those cities were really inspiring to me, and some of the greatest artists that I look up to come from those cities, and they have a wonderful history, and I just think it's a good start for some travel. So I had been planning for a very long time with my previous boyfriends to move to London as my starting place. I hadn't been to any of these places before. It was just, I'm just gonna move. That's sort of how I do things. I don't really travel. Like, I have traveled to Japan and to New York and LA, but Japan was a school trip, and LA initially was part of a business trip for music, and then I loved it so much that I just, like, I had to go back there. I love LA. Like, LA is my favorite place in the world, even though I haven't really been to that many places, but so far it is my favorite place in the world. I really feel connected there. There's so much cool vintage culture there. There's an amazing vegan culture and the food culture in general, and then they're really into like health and spirituality and fitness, and all of that really resonates with me, and it has the most amazing climate ever. Like, I am a beach bunny. I love the ocean. I grew up every day on the beach and doing swimming training and stuff, so that's definitely me, and I like to integrate the two together. And the only place in the world where I've found other people that seem to do all of those things is LA, so it really kind of resonates with me. But anyway, so I was planning to move to London, and then my last trip to LA made me really want to move to America, but I looked into like the visas and stuff, and financially I can't afford to go through the whole O-1 performance visa process. It costs anywhere between like $5,000 and $10,000, and I didn't have that kind of cash. So I decided that I would go to Montreal, because I wanted to learn French. I've always wanted to do that, which is one of the motivators to go to Paris, was so that I could learn French, or to live in Paris was so I could learn French. That kind of, in my head, became like a childhood dream, and the reality was if I wanted to live somewhere affordable that was part of the Commonwealth, making it easier for me as an Australian to go there because they have all of the Commonwealth agreements and it's easy for us to move between those countries. So I was like, oh, it's in Canada, I'd be learning French, but people still speak English there, and it's, you know, just like an hour, hour and a half flight to New York City, where I have friends and performance opportunities and things there. So I was really keen to move to Montreal, and I was saving for this right in 2016. And then I met Val, and he didn't live here, he lived in France, and I just met him when he was traveling in Australia, and I was like, wow. I only knew him, we were like dating in Australia for 2 months, knowing that he was gonna leave, like we were just kind of hanging out, and was like, this is finite, but at least like we really like each other and we want to spend time together. And then he left and I was devastated. Like I've never been affected like that by someone, and I knew I had to see him again. And originally my plan was to stop by Paris on my way to Montreal, instead of stopping via LA or via London, was to stop in Paris and see him maybe for a couple of weeks, meet him here, and then go on to Montreal and just, I don't know what I was expecting, but it was like, I just have to see this person again. And then, because there was a 6 month gap between when he left and when I was going wherever it was that I was going to go, I had enough time, like we chatted literally every day. Like we had some ridiculous amount of messages, like I think it was like 70,000 messages back and forth in 6 months, which is kind of insane. Like we really connected. And so I decided eventually to look into how it would be to move to Paris. And a beautiful friend of mine, and she was had been a jazz singer in Paris, and she was like, you know, you can be a musician in Paris, there's no reason why you can't, you should just go to Paris anyway, like don't go there for a short time, go there and like experience Paris, like be there, and then if you want to go somewhere else afterwards you can go, but don't like stop there for 2 weeks. That was her advice to me, and that really resonated with me, because as I said, ever since I was little I wanted to immerse myself and have life experiences rather than just like travel experiences. So yeah, I mean that's kind of what happened. And then we arranged to meet each other in Paris and move in together, which is kind of crazy because we like dated for 8 weeks in Australia. So we just went from like that to messaging overseas. And then we met in Paris and we immediately moved in with each other. And here we are. The next question, at Don B. Superkiss, Don B. Superkiss. Your products are vegan, but are they also under the World Trade Organization's free trade? I only gave a brief response to this question. I have a feeling it actually might be some trolling, like when I looked at the account, but that doesn't really matter to me because it was a good question. And I have mentioned before, for those of you who follow the channel for vintage reasons, that I am vegan. I generally believe in veganism as standing up for the rights of animals, but also for the greater environmental good. The livestock industry is a huge contributor to pollution and also to negative health effects, adverse health effects on the population in Australia and basically in the Western world. I mean, recently they did research that revealed that processed red meat in particular, should be considered just as dangerous for our health as smoking, which is pretty massive. And that's because of all of the chemicals that they put into the food. It's not food. But my point is that for me, being vegan isn't just about being compassionate towards animals and being motivated to speak out for animals. I think we should be doing whatever we can all the time to try and make an impact on the world and make the world a better place for us to live as human beings and also for animals to live as well. And everyone deserves a voice. And so this question really resonated with me because, no, it's not something I thought of when I put my makeup online. Like, I've been vegan for about 3 years, but the process of becoming vegan is a slow transition and I don't have a lot of money. Like I've mentioned, I'm a musician and I've just moved overseas. I have a very limited budget. By the time you try and get vegan, organic, fair trade, the price of things is very, very high. And this is problematic because obviously it needs to cost more in order for us to be actually paying for what we're buying. So the cost of meat, the cost of goods should be higher. But you also have to live within your means and do what you can do. At the moment, I'm working on making sure that all of my makeup products are vegan because I had to be clear out. Like, as I say, I've been vegan for 3 years and some makeup products last a long time and I'm not into wasting stuff. So I have been using products that aren't vegan because they're left from the days before I went vegan. And that because when I moved over here, I basically didn't bring anything with me. I've been slowly rebuying products that are entirely vegan. And that's what I'm concentrating on at the moment. Would I like to make sure that they're under the World Trade Organization's free trade? Yes, and to be honest, thank you for the comment, because I will definitely pay attention to that and see if I can make that contribution. I can't promise that I will definitely buy those products all the time, because I don't have a high income. I don't even have like a kind of middle class income. I'm on like minimum wage, so I have to do the best that I can. That question obviously got me thinking a lot, because I've gone like on a massive tangent, but there you go. Everyone is asking, what lipstick is that? On every video, like multiple times. I will keep answering the question if it's the first time you've asked me on that particular shade. I'm not gonna answer every time someone asks what lipstick is that, because like literally on every video people ask me the same question, and like if you scroll through the comments I've already answered it. But lipstick, okay, so this one is Jeffree Star, but I almost always now wear Kat Von D's lipsticks, and usually I wear the liquid lipsticks because I like the way that the finish is, like they've got a matte finish, which as I've said before is not necessarily authentic, but I just like it. The general wear, because I don't like having to reapply my lipstick. Like, I have better things to do than go to the bathroom constantly and check my makeup and my hair. Like, you do it in the morning, you move on. So yeah, Kat Von D liquid lipsticks. My two favorite colors are my like everyday red that I wear like for day and night, like it's a full kind of coverage one, is Outlaw. And my like deep kind of vampy colored one that I really love is Vampira. You can tell that I live in France. Vampira. And I'm not actually sure what color this one is. I'm sorry, I'll put it in the comments below. Next question. At Victoria Vintage, I'm just wondering how you two met, meaning me and Val. Okay, the story of how Val and I actually met is really cute and sounds like bullshit, but it's actually true. It's kind of like the plot to Before Sunrise. I'm not kidding. So it was New Year's Eve 2015 to 2016. And I had been at my best friend's party on the Docklands Harbour, because she had a really cool apartment at the time with a rooftop garden, and we wanted to watch the fireworks from there. But I had promised my housemate that I would come and meet them on Albert Park Lake for the actual fireworks at midnight, because my housemate was working until 11:30, which meant he like wasn't really able to do anything for New Year's. So a couple of other of his friends were going to meet us, so it was going to be like five of us with champagne and just like bringing the new year like that, which I thought would be lovely, and I'd get to see multiple friends. Anyway, so I was at my friend's rooftop party on the Docklands, and so the building was like super new and fancy, and they have these swipe cards. You can't get in the elevator and go anywhere unless you have your room key card. Anyway, my friend had gone upstairs with her hubby to do something. Anyway, they disappeared for a long time, and I was waiting for them to come back, and I was like, oh my god, I'm not gonna make it. It is getting so close to midnight. So anyway, at the last minute, they came downstairs and gave me the key card, rushed upstairs. Then I ran to the tram, and I got on at like 10 to 12, and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm not gonna make it by midnight, but at least I can make it just after and like wish them Happy New Year. So anyway, we get to between the city and Etihad Stadium, and it hit midnight, and the tram driver stopped the tram in between the city and Etihad Stadium, so we could literally see nothing. No fireworks, city lights, nothing. It was just windows from city buildings. And he was like, I'm not going anywhere, it's midnight, I'm gonna call my family. Everyone on the tram was like, that is such a dick move. And suddenly, this gorgeous Frenchman runs up and kisses me on each cheek and tells me it's okay to kiss me on each cheek because he's French and because it's midnight and we need to celebrate. And then the guy who's with, who turned out to be his cousin, gave me a bottle of gin and told me to have a drink. And I was like, things is looking up. This is good. So that is how we met. At Atlantean Bloodlayer, what line of work are you in? I am many things, but first and foremost, I am a musician. Slightly ironic, because in Paris, for two reasons, I did come here to do music, but I've been quite unwell for the last 7 months. And also, I found out that my visa doesn't let me stay. So more on that in another video, but I can't stay here. So the amount of energy that I want to put into building a foundation for doing music in Paris when I will have to leave very soon is limited. So that's why I've been pouring my time into YouTube, because you can literally do that wherever you are. You're not limited by your location. Not that you can't do that with music. Like, I'm sure that I would like to perform in Paris and that is worth the networking, and I will put some time into it before I leave. But to like really set myself up to do my full-on shows and stuff here, no, I can't be bothered. But to just kind of go to jams and things and meet musos and just connect with people, yeah, absolutely. So I do that. I'm also a voice coach, so I teach people how to use their voice in many, many different ways. I'm really anatomy focused, and so I specialize in what I call vocal diversity. So if you come and have lessons from me, then you will learn how to access lots of different vocal styles in your singing, whether you want to do like Broadway belt, rock singing, jazz, folk singing. Often people are told, I'm sorry, this is your vocal style, you're only capable of doing this, and it's just such rubbish, and it makes me really mad because we all have the same anatomy. I mean, yes, you're gonna have your niche, the thing you're the best at, and you might focus on that at some point, but it doesn't mean you actually physically can't sing in a different way. That's just ridiculous. I do that as well. And then, yeah, I do YouTube now. It's quite reasonably new, but I'm a performing artist. And then I've done like a gazillion other jobs in my life because, let's face it, performing artists never know where their next job is coming from. So they do a billion other things to make sure they can pay their rent and eat. McKenna Schwenk, could you do a daily outfits video? Yes, I can. And I'm going to this month. At Julia Cohen, do you have any advice for pin curling with longer hair? Yes, I've had hair down to here and still done pin curling, so you can do it. My advice is split the hair up into smaller sections when you do the pin curling so that it dries better, and also so that your pin curl doesn't end up too big by the time you ravel all your hair up into it. You still want your individual pin curl to be quite small so that your curl is tight. Use a very good setting lotion and a very good hairspray because the length of your hair will drag your curls out just because it's long. And thirdly, accept it's not going to look like a Jane Mansfield or like a Vivian Leigh style look. It's going to look more like Lana Turner or Rita Hayworth, who had longer hair. It's just going to have that more slick, long look to it, but you'll still get a nice edge and a nice curl under at the bottom. But yeah, it's just not going to have quite the same look, but you can definitely still pin curl. I'm just going to accept that that's falling out because it's happening and whatever. At Pancakes and Tea, what type of brush should I use? Honestly, I do vintage hairstyles all the time, and I currently don't have anything other than a normal comb and a rat tail teasing brush, neither of which are designed to brush your hair, but I brush my hair all the time with both of them. I comb my hair in the shower and it's got conditioner in it. And in terms of just like brushing my hair, if I go 2 or 3 days without washing it, then I brush it with the teasing brush, which is probably really, really bad. And it's definitely destroying my teasing brush. But I would recommend a paddle brush. Like, they were pretty popular in the vintage era, just like the oval shaped ones. A lot of them have like an orangey pink curved base, and then it's got bristles coming out. Just make sure, please, 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 even if you're not vegan, just please make sure that it is a vegan brush, that the bristles are not boar bristles, which is really popular, because please, let's not harm animals for beauty. It's just not justified. Do we really need to torture a poor friggin' monkey or rabbit so that we can brush our hair or put lipstick on? Like, seriously, no, guys, seriously. At Rachel Twelfth Tree, I hope I'm saying that right. What type of Remington hot roller set do you use? I've had a couple of different ones. I'm really not sure what my first one was, which is a shame because it was fantastic and it gave me the best curls I've ever had, and I don't really like my new one that much. Like, the pins on my old one were like single metallic wire, and they meant that I could like pin my rollers to really close to my scalp. And my new ones have got like these plastic clip rollers that just, the top of the roller just slowly falls out of my hair while it's in, and I really don't like it that much. And they've got a velvet coating on them, which is really good for not damaging my hair, but it sort of insulates them, and so the curlers don't heat my hair up as much, and my curl isn't as good. So it's not amazing. I'll tell you what it is, but it's not amazing. It just says Remington, but it doesn't really matter. Like, you don't need the same one as me. You don't even need a hot roller set. You could use hot sticks. They come up with like a really good curl. In fact, that's probably more authentic because a lot of the women in the 40s had permed hair to make setting easier. So you can use hot sticks, which will give you a smaller, tighter curl. You just need to brush out way more. So don't like freak out when you take your hair out because you'll have like an afro, but they work. I just recommend if you get a hot roller set to get the ones with the 3 different sizes, because that will really help get more defined curls around your face, and then you'll get like the bigger curls to create volume at the back with the big barrels. But yeah, I mean, you can even use a curling iron if you want to. It's more about the technique of rolling the curl than it is about the type of curling tool that you have, if that makes sense. Yes, don't forget to watch my video. At Dorothy, I wonder if you have any suggestions or could you make a video for mature women who are interested in this lifestyle? I actually found that really interesting. I hadn't thought of that, but I really like that concept. Obviously, I'm not in the mature age group. I'm getting there, but I'm not there yet. Hold off. I might do a video of like inspiring women with a great fashion sense and sense of style that mature women who are interested in the vintage lifestyle can look up to and who I've looked up to forever and just be like, man, I hope it looked like that when I'm getting older. I like hope I'm that classy. Like Helen Mirren, hello, sexy as hell, gorgeous, has aged gracefully, hasn't gone and got a whole lot of like Botox and stuff done. Like she's just accepted her age and gets that you can still be beautiful and sexy and classy no matter what age you are, which I totally think is true. So there's my first tip, but I will actually do a video on that because I think that's really cool. At Paul P, are you a hairdresser? Oh, no, I'm not a hairdresser, but I do ask a lot of questions when I go to the hairdresser. So I've like asked my friends who are hairdressers and my hairdressers that I've gone to throughout the years how they do things to like learn from them. I've done a lot of research, like I read a lot of blogs and a lot of hairdressing articles, and I've searched for like cutting patterns to find out how they cut hair for particular eras to help create certain styles, because your haircut is very, very important, which is why I made a vintage haircut video. And I've been doing my hair in really elaborate fancy styles ever since I was like 7 or 8 years old. Like my mum used to put me to bed and then in the morning I would get up and I would have done my hair like in my entire head in braids, or I would have created a French roll, or like I did the craziest hairstyles instead of sleeping. I was a busy child. I was like swimming and doing surfing and basketball and lots of after school activities. The only time I had to practice like hairstyles was at night. Now I'm good at not doing it in front of the mirror. And my last question, and I think I might elaborate on this in another video because this is a topic that I'm really into, but the last question comes from at Rothwell Lizzie, and is actually from Instagram. And Lizzie asked me, what star sign am I? And probably not very surprisingly, I am a Leo. I don't know if you believe in star signs, but I think if you do and you know anything about star signs, it won't really surprise you that I'm a Leo. Like, I have lots of hair and I'm obsessed with it. I have a like pretty bubbly personality. I'm kind of outgoing and incredibly talkative. And all of those things are generally associated with being a Leo, along with many other things, some of them good, some of them bad, but in general, I really like being a Leo. And I'm really into numerology and stuff as well. So like, if you guys would like to know more about star signs and numerology and like what my numerology is, let me know in the comments below and I'll do a video on that, because I do like yoga and meditation and I read like horoscopes and numerology books and things. So yeah, I hope I'm not disappointing any of you, but that's the reality of who I am. Okay, so that is video number one from the 30 videos in 30 days challenge and my first Q&A. If you have any questions, put them in the comments box below. They'll go into my next Q&A video, or I may just answer them in the comments as I often do. That's it, guys. Do stick around for the 30 days. I hope you will follow me through this. I will upload a video every day. Feel free to put some suggestions below, and if they don't get made in the 30 days, then I might make them later on. Because I do like making requested videos. That's fun. I like knowing what you guys want to watch. And keep watching for the 30 days, because on day 30, I'm going to announce a surprise for y'all. So it'll be worth sticking about. I will announce in more detail what that surprise is going to be further down the track into this month. Thanks for watching, guys. Hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, give it a thumbs up. If you're just a troll, then don't forget to subscribe. Like, even I'm guilty of this. Like, my favorite YouTubers, and then I'll be watching them regularly, and then I'll realize I never even subscribed to their channel. So please subscribe. Click the button below. Leave a comment. Follow me on Instagram. I'm always on Instagram, so it's just at Miss B-Town. It's the same as on here. Feel free to send me a private message if you have any questions or you want to, like, connect with me. Yeah, cool. And I'll see you next time. Bye.